Amen. All the praise and all the glory belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Rabbul Alameen, the sustainer, the maintainer, the nourisher, the provider, and without any doubt, sovereignty in the heavens and the earth belong only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This year we will inshallah discuss, you know, Surah 44 in the Quran, which is Surah Ad-Dukhan. This is one of the three surahs, as you know, that our Aima alayhim salam have recommended to be recited on the Laylatul Qadr night of the 23rd of Ramadan. This is the shortest of the three surahs. The three surahs that we recite are Surah Ar-Rum, Surah Al-Ankabut, and also Surah Ad-Dukhan. Surah Ad-Dukhan is the shortest, and therefore I've chosen this surah for you. It has got amazing lessons, you know, for us to learn. It has got 59 ayat, and we shall see as we go along, inshallah ta'ala. Now, Ad-Dukhan itself, the word Ad-Dukhan means, you know, the smoke. And it actually refers to the smoke that will appear on the last day, on the day of the Qiyamah. There are two places in the Quran where Ad-Dukhan is mentioned. One is in Surah Al-Fusilat. There Ad-Dukhan is mentioned at the time of the creation of the universe, the creation of the earth. In this surah, Ad-Dukhan is mentioned towards the end, you know, the last days on this earth. So the Ad-Dukhan is mentioned in ayat number 10 in this surah, Fartaqib, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Fartaqib yawma ta'ati samaw bid-dukhanin mubin. This will be in ayat number 10. The translation is, then watch you for the day that the sky will bring forth a kind of smoke or mist which will be plainly visible. This is in ayat number 10 in this particular surah. Now the word Dukhan, as I have just told you, it appears twice. First we see in Surah Al-Fusilat, which is Surah number 41, ayat number 11. And then it refers to the beginning. There it refers to the beginning of the world. The other occasion is in this surah, Ad-Dukhan, which makes it a reference to the end of the world. The subject matter that we will inshallah study in this surah will show us the great importance of the Quran, you know, for our guidance. It will also show that it was revealed on the night of Laylatul Qadr. It shows the unity. It shows that it is revealed on the night of the decree Laylatul Qadr. And it shows the final results that will be for the disbelievers. It also discusses, you know, the story of Nabi Musa alayhi salam. It also shows us the stories of the children of Israel. It discusses Fir'aun and why is this creation that we have is so useful, and the creation of the heavens and the earth. So this is all we will see in this particular surah, inshallah. So it is a tall order, you know, for us. But my request, you know, to you is to please come early, please come in time, ask questions during the question time, if time permits, because I will give you in the end, you know, some time to ask questions as well. And please tell your friends, you know, to come, you know, make notes, as you know, this will help you discuss at home with your children, with your families and your friends. So it's very important. Now, what are we told by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, about this surah is, you know, that it is reported in Majmu' al-Bayan in volume 9 that Rasulullah has said that one who recites Surah Ad-Dukhan on Friday in the day and at night, Allah will have a mansion built for him in the Jannat. Also, he is reported to have said, one who recites Surah Ad-Dukhan in one night, he will awaken when 70,000 angels ask for his forgiveness. So these are the words of Rasulullah as reported in Majmu' al-Bayan. Now, you know, let me explain to you, you know, when this can happen. These are the words of Rasulullah, and Rasulullah does not lie. So, you know, this word, so the reality of this, you know, the fulfillment of this can only happen, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, give us the tawfiq, you know, for this to happen. Now, it can only happen not only just by reciting, although in Arabic, man qara'a, means whoever recites this, does not mean only reciting. It It means also to interiorize, one who interiorizes within himself or herself and acts accordingly to what the Quran has revealed, then sure, then all these benefits are definite to happen because it is the promise and it is the words of Rasulullah as it is reported. So it is interiorizing which will lead our life according to what is revealed, then the benefits can happen. So now the first ayat in this surah, then A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem, Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. The first ayat begins with Ha Mim. What is Ha Mim? These letters are called, Huruful Muqattaat. There are 29 surahs in the Quran that begin with Huruful Muqattaat. What is Huruful Muqattaat? Huruf is the plural of harf. Harf is a letter. Huruf are letters. So huruf al-muqattaat, muqattaat are the cut letters. It means that when we recite these, we cannot recite them jointly. We have to cut them. Ha, mim, alif, lam, mim, ta, ha, ta, sin, mim, alif, lam, mim, ra, alif, lam, ra. Like that, we cannot recite. So if we have got alif, lam, mim, we cannot recite it. Alam, that would be wrong. Because these are huruful muqatta, they have to be recited. Each and every harf, each and every letter has to be recited separately. So 29 surahs, the surahs is an English word. The plural in Arabic is suwar. So 29 surahs begin with huruful muqatta. The lowest number of the letters is one letter. There are three surahs in the Quran that have got just only one letter. Noon, Qaf, Sa'ad, three surahs, they've got only one letter. So three surahs. And then nine surahs begin with two letters. Taha, Yasin, Ha'im. 13 surahs with three letters, Alif, Lam, Mim, and others. Two surahs with four letters, and two surahs with five letters. So the minimum number is one, and the maximum number is five letters. So you have got 3 plus 9 plus 13 plus 2 plus 2 will give you 29 surahs. So 29 surahs in the Quran that have got the Huruful Muqattaat. Now we will discuss them in some detail a little later, but for now just keep in mind that the 29 surahs begin with Huruful Muqattaat. And although there are many explanations given by the Mufassirin and the Ulama and the scholars, even in the time of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, we have got a companion by the name of Ibn Abbas who has looked at all the surahs with all Huruful Muqattaat and has come up with some explanation. With those explanations, if you read them or if you listen to them, they are so plausible. But yet, even though they are plausible, we are told that none of them has been revealed by Allah and His Rasul or the Imams. So, these are explanations only given. So, individually, we are not allowed to make any conjectures about these names, about these letters. Okay, so we will discuss, inshallah, some very interesting explanations by the ulama, both in our books and also in the Sunni scholars. So, let's look at one. Very interesting explanation right now. So we are told a companion by the name Ibn Abbas, who was also the companion of Imam Ali ibn Talib alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, has given some interesting explanations of Huruful Muqattaat. So let's look at one. Take this one, Alif, Lam, Mim. It is reported that Ibn Abbas said that Alif stands for Ana. Ana means what in Arabic? Ana means I. Ana. Arabic word meaning I or I am. Lam stands for Allah. Now the unique thing here is, that here is Allah. The middle letter is L. And in the name Allah, the middle letter is also Lam. Do you see this? So Alif, Lam. So Lam stands for Allah. And then you have got Mim stands for A'lamu, A'lamu. So then you have got a complete sentence, Ana Allahu A'lamu. It means that I am Allah who knows all. I am Allah A'lamu who knows everything. Okay, so, you know, so it is very clear then. So, you know, like that, we have got very, very interesting explanations about all the surahs that have got Huruful Muqatta'at. We can explore more, but more important to understand that none of them has never been proven to be directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or his Rasul, and it's never been transmitted by the Imams. Now, let us begin with Surah Ad-Dukhan. So now we have got the first ayat begins with Hamim. Oops. And then the second ayat, Wal-Kitab al-Mubin, by the book that makes things very clear. So it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that this is the book, the Quran, which makes things clear. The clear message in the message is you know, mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and warning to mankind against evil. The message is, you know, for the human life on earth, and the message is very plain, very simple and clear for mankind to understand. It bears testimony to the truth. Mufassirin are actually telling us that the clarity points to the absolute, manifest and undeniable truth, just as the sun is the testimony for the existence of sun. It is that clear if you really ponder over it and try to understand this. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatin mubarakatin inna kunna munzirin. We sent it down, this is ayat number 3, we sent it down during the blessed night, Laylatul Qadr, for we, that is Allah, for we ever wish to warn against evil. Now, you know, the Quran, you know, tells us that in Surah Al-Baqarah, in ayat number 185, you know, Shahr Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it is the Shahr Ramadan in which was revealed the Quran. In this surah, we are told it was revealed on Laylatul Qadr. So now we know now for sure that it was revealed in the month of Ramadan. The Quran has said this, Shahr Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Quran, and here it says that it was revealed on the night of Laylatul Qadr. So Quran was revealed Ramadan, and it was revealed on Laylatul Qadr. So it's combined with this ayah then makes it clear that Quran was revealed in the month of Ramadan. Now the word revealed is, you know, Laylatul Mubarak. So if you look at that ayat again, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatin mubarakatin. Inna kunna munzirin. So the word revealed here is, the words are, you know, laylatin mubarakatin. So this then becomes a blessed night. It is the night of Laylatul Qadr. It is the night where all good things are happening. The majority of Mufassirin have said that this is the night of the Qadr, of the decree, because it says in Laylatul Qadr, Inna anzalnahu fi Laylatul Qadr. What is Qadr? Qadr is, you know, decree. It is a blessed night on which was the revelation of the Holy Quran. And this night is not only for 1 year, it is recurrence. So every year we have got Laylatul Qadr. And so every year the blessing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, showers his blessings upon those who go through this night, realizing that this is the night where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has opened all the gates, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is accepting from us all our prayers. So, you know, further then, we are told, you know, that it is a night on which the fates of humanity, so our Qadr, our decree, our life is written. So, you know, our fate, our future is of, you know, humanity, and what will happen in 1 year that follows after that are predestined. So the destiny is formed on this particular night. It is predestined. It is the night, said, therefore it is the night for ibadat. So you know, what we have to do is, if we have to make use of this night, doing the ibadat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listens to that, is the Laylatul Qadr, and he's openly willing to receive ibadat from us, and that he is willing to give whatever we ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah wa ta'ala. So then the Quran was revealed fully upon the heart of Rasulullah. So, you know, that sentence in Laylatul Qadr, Inna anzalnahu fi Laylatul Qadr, the meaning of that is that the whole of the Quran was revealed in the heart of Rasulullah. So the Quran was fully revealed upon the heart of Rasulullah. The ulama are actually pointing out that this indicates that the whole of the Quran in its entirety was revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali. Can we have one salawat, please? Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. It was revealed to Rasulullah on the night of Laylatul Qadr. Because we are speaking about this Laylatul Qadr, we are speaking about Rasulullah, it is always better to fill up this atmosphere with, salawat upon Rasulullah, because Allah and his angels are sending the salawat themselves as well. So now if you remember then how the ayat in Surah Al-Qadr begins. It begins, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. Surely, inna in Arabic means surely, without any doubt. Inna, surely, we have revealed this Quran in the night of the Qadr. Qadr is power, the night of decree, the night when the decrees are formed, the night when the destinies are formed. That is the night of Laylatul Qadr, when this Quran was revealed. Now, what was the main purpose behind its revelation? Okay, it is mentioned, as we see in ayat number 3, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatin mubarakatin, inna kunna munzirin. We sent it down during a blessed night of Laylatul Qadr, for we ever want, we wish to warn against the evil. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave rise to his messengers, to the anbiya, so that they should warn against shirk. They should warn. So, united message of all the anbiya. When I speak to my students in the university, this is the first thing I tell them, that the purpose of the messengers and the prophet was only one. So if you look, starting from the first prophet, Nabi Adam alayhi salam, to the last one, they all had one united message. The message was what? The La ilaha illallah. That there is no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That this life is only temporary. It is not permanent. We will all die. And then in the end, there will be the day of judgment. This is the unity of the message from all the anbiya. So here then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave rise to his messengers so that they should warn against the shirk and against wrongdoing, and as Mufassirin tell us, to proclaim the final prophethood of the final Rasul. So you find in the Quran that all the prophets who came previously, they all prophesied of the coming of Rasulullah. And it is very unique. So if you really study, the Bible as well. So if you look at the Bible, book of Deuteronomy, where you see this prophecy very clear. I mean, Musa is giving the prophecy. And if you look and if you read the words, even if it is in English, you read those words and you compare it with the verse with the ayat in Surah Al-Jumu'ah. Huwallazi ba'atha fil ummiyina rasulan minhum yatlu alayhim ayatihi wa yuzakkihim wa yuallimuhumul kitaba wal hikmah. It will be exactly the same wording that you find Nabi Musa is telling to the children of Bani Israel, that there will be a prophet who will come from amongst you, and then وَالَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِنْهُ يَطْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. You find it in Book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18. Very similar prophecy is in the Gospel of John, where, Nabi Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam, Jesus is, saying that, don't think that I have come to change any laws. I have not come to change it. I have come to reinforce law. But there will be another. I have to leave. I have to go. Because unless I go, the other one cannot come. The other one who will be Parakletos. Parakletos is Muhammad, the praised one. So, then of course in the Greek it has been conjugated, it's been changed, but the actual word is Parakletos, which means the praised one. And who is the praised one? Muhammad. So the name Muhammad itself means the praised one. So then it is very clear that, so the Anbiya came and they gave news, they gave the prophecy of the final prophet to come, of which, the Quran is the last link of the chain of that prophethood. It is the final and pristine. It is what is the uniqueness about the Quran is untainted. There is no tahrif in the Quran. there's no change even in the fatha, in the kathra, in the dhamma, in the sukoon. No change at all. Ayatollah Khoi Rahimullah had produced a book, Al-Bayan Fi Tafsir Al-Qur'an, in which he is saying that there is no tahrif in the Qur'an, not even in iota. And I don't know if you read the news, you know, I think it was only last week, that they've discovered one Qur'an in the UK, in the museum, that is believed to be the first Qur'an in the time of Rasulullah. It is quite unique. And that Qur'an, they said it exactly as it is right now, exactly as it is. And you know, they're saying that we don't know who wrote this Qur'an, or who you know, which scribe it was, who took all the revelation. But you know, this report said that, you know, it is quite likely that this person who wrote this was also in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So, you know, it is a pristine, untainted message that will remain protected. It will remain protected from tahrif. It is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. You find this in Surah Al-Hajj, Hijr, which is, I think, Surah number 15, I think it is, in the Quran, where you find this ayat, you know, the inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra. It is us who have revealed this, and it is us who are going to protect it. So this protection is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There can never be any tahrif in the Quran. It was revealed on this blessed night when sins are forgiven and abundant blessings are available. Fiha yufraku kullu amrin hakim. This is ayat number 4. In that night is made distinct every affair. Now, I have forgotten my watch, so let me see how much time I have, because that's important. Okay. Fiha yufraku kullu amrin hakim. In that night, it is made distinct. So every affair is made distinct of wisdom. So now, mufassirin are you know, telling us that this is the night when whatever everyone has to receive for the coming year is decreed. It is on this night, on Laylatul Qadr. We are told that, you know, that this is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, has asked believers, you know, to spend the whole night in ibadat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in dua for forgiveness of sins, you know, for our sustenance, and life and death are decreed. And hopes, you know, with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are fulfilled. Our imams have left for us, you know, beautiful supplications of du'as for this night, which we recite. And, you know, we are very, 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 very fortunate. I know of a person who converted to Islam, a Canadian, homegrown person converted to Islam. And he was working in the office, you know, somewhere. And in that office, there was also one another Shia person also working. And the Shia person introduced him to the books of du'as, Saifatu Sajadiyya, and, you know, other du'as. And when he read that, he said, you know, to this person, I am amazed, he said, you know, this doesn't look like the words of any human beings. And I know that these are not the words from God. So this must be so special. And he converts. He becomes, you know, the Shia. And he actually came and gave us a talk, you know, one day in Mississauga, in the program of, you know, Waliul Asr School, in one of the programs that they had. So it is, so, you know, we have got this du'as, we've got the, you know, the treasure, you know, that's with us, you know, that we should actually utilize, especially in this month of Ramadan. Amrun min abdina inna kunna mursaleen. By command, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is ayat number 5 now. By command, says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from our presence. So this command comes from Allah's presence himself. For we ever send revelations. Rahmatu min rabbika innahu huwas samiul alim. This is ayat number 6. As a mercy from your Rabb. Now, you know, this word Lord, you know, the translation of the word Lord, I've actually put here, you know, especially to, so that I can explain to you. You know, Lord is not really a good translation, you know, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, because the first English translation, you know, was made by Christians, and you know, they translated, you know, the word Allah, you know, is Lord, but the Lord has got the meaning like, you know, some, you know, some very special human being, you know, like, you know, referring to Jesus. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so the best word, I think, to translate, you know, of Rab instead of Lord, I would like to translate it into sustainer. That would be the closest, you know, sustainer. And if you look at the modern translations, you know, that we have, they don't translate as Lord. You know, they translate it as, you know, sustainer, so instead of Lord. So as a mercy from your Lord, you know, from your sustainer, there's nothing wrong if you say Lord. I'm just saying that, you know, a better word than Lord is, you know, sustain. Even sustainer does not fully actually satisfy the meaning of Rab. Is, you know, sustainer, maintainer, nourisher, cherisher, provider, everything together is Rab. So, but you can say, you know, sustainer will be the closest. So it's a mercy from your sustainer, for he hears and he knows all things. So his infinite mercy. What is the meaning of infinite? Infinite means so much that you cannot reach to the bottom of it. There's no finite, there's no finity to it. There's no sky, there's no limit to it. It's limitless. Infinite mercy does not abandon his servants. Allah's mercy does not abandon his servants. I gave you that example yesterday as well, that, you know, that Allah's rahmah, you can never, ever, never, ever reach upon. You know, think about this. You know, think about this, you know, beautiful example given to us by, I think it was Mullah Sadr. He said, you know, how many times are you going to give thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because with every breath that you do, you are doing the shukr. So if I breathe, what have I done? I've taken life in me. I should really say, alhamdulillah. I should do the shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then when I breathe out, what have I done? I've taken all the dirt outside of my body. I put life in me by breathing. So how many times do I breathe in a day? 10,000 times, 20,000 times, I don't know the figure. But it's impossible. We cannot give thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, never ever. And this is what Imam Ali says, and I gave you the translation yesterday of that beautiful sermon of Imam Ali from Najul Balagha, the very first, you know, sermon which we read yesterday, and I also gave you the translation. Where, you know, it is impossible. Allah tells us in the Quran, you take all the trees of the world, you know, cut them, make them into pencils, and take all the seas of the world. You know, 75% of the earth is covered with water. So Allah said, you know, take all these waters, convert them into ink, and all the trees, cut them into pencils, and start writing, start counting all the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll never be able to finish it, even if you put other seven seas like that. It's not possible. So we cannot really thank Allah's mercy upon us is so uniquely great. And I told you, I gave you that beautiful hadith al-Qudsi actually yesterday as well, that Allah has said that I have divided my mercies into 100 parts, and all the mercies and all the blessings that you see is only one part in this world which we cannot even count. I have reserved 99 parts for those who will go into the Jannat. So 100% of mercies, we cannot fathom, we cannot even imagine. That's why we are not really allowed to, you know, speculate about what it will be. We can only say things what we read in the Quran, what we have been told in the Hadith, and what we are told from the Masumin al-Islam. Otherwise, to speculate things about Jannat is also, we are not allowed to do that because it is impossible. The goodness and the rahmah and the blessings are so uniquely great that it's impossible for us, for anyone to fathom. So here then, you know, so he grants us whatever is best for us and in the time that is what is best. So, you know, he gives us what is best for us and in the time when it's going to be best for us. So, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listens to all our du'as. As a matter of fact, in that passage in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, where you get Shahrul Ramadan alladhi unzila fil Quran, in the same passage, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals and says, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِ أَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. When my servants, oh Muhammad, oh my Rasul, when my servants come to ask you about me, that is about Allah, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِ أَنِّي, tell them that I am very near to them, and I hear and I listen to each and every prayer that they do. The only condition is that tell them, you know, that they should have yaqeen in me, that they should have, you know, full, you know, yakin that, you know, that I've listened to the dua and I'll fulfill them. But when to fulfill? That is in the hands of Allah, because He wants all the best for us. So what I'm saying here, that, you know, that He will fulfill it in the time that is, He will actually fulfill whatever is best for us, but also in the time that is best for us. Because, you know, there may be time when it may not be best for us. You know, I can give you several examples in my life as well. You know, I can actually give you one very clear example, you know, right here. You know, we are, you know, seven brothers in the home and only one sister, okay? Now, my mother always used to do the dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me one daughter. But every time it was sons, every time. After six brothers, we have one sister, you know. But, you know, this dua, Allah, but, it was destined that my mother was going to pass away very young. She passed away at the age of 36. My father was left with seven sons and one daughter. Could you imagine how difficult it would be? So, you know, I mean, there are many, many incidents in our own life, you know, where we do the dua and may not be fulfilled immediately, but you will see that it will be fulfilled when it is the best for us. I mean, it's fulfilled and it's fulfilled in multiple forms. It's quite amazing. So, you know, this knowledge is with Allah alone, for surely He is all-hearing, all-knowing. Innahu wa Samiul Alim, says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, Rahmatu min Rabbika, in ayat number 6, Rahmatu min Rabbika, innahu wa Samiul Alim, that He is all-hearing and all, without any doubt, He is all-hearing and all-knowing. So He knows what are our wishes, what are our desires. He is asking us to ask from Him, and to have surety that He is listening to our du'as and that He will fulfill it when it is best for us to be fulfilled. So everything actually emanated from His infinite mercy that, you know, that the humanity enjoys. رَبِّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِن كُنْتُمْ مُوقِنِينَ. So the Rabb, see, I use the word Rabb, the sustainer, the Rabb of the heavens and the earth, and all that is between them, if you but have an assured faith with certainty. So if you have a faith for certainty that He is the sustainer, and we see very clearly that He is, okay, because He, everything is created ex nihilo. So in رَبِّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا إِن كُنْتُمْ مُوقِنِينَ, the Rabb, the sustainer of the heavens and the earth, and all that is between them, and what is in them, and what is all between them. So if we have that assured faith with certainty, now, you know, let us try to realize this, you know, very carefully. You know, there's a decision of, here is the discussion of one of Rububiyyah, that Allah is the Rabb. He's the Rabb, He's the sustainer. Now, it's still difficult to just say, you know, sustainer. Rabb is called, it's difficult to translate it fully in any language. You know, Rabb is, you know, cherisher, sustainer, nourisher, provider, you know, all those things. So it is, you know, it's called the Rububiyyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the divine attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the sustainer, cherisher, nourisher, provider of everything. He is the Lord of the heavens, the earth, all that exists between them and in them, and all creatures. When we give careful consideration and think of all the creation and guidance we have been provided on the path of perfection, this should certainly pave the way for acquiring the total belief. So, you know, one way to acquire, you know, the total belief is to really think, is to really ponder, you know, ponder ourselves, you know. Let me ask you one question, you know. Can anyone create anything from nothing? Impossible. No one can create anything from nothing. So who has created all this universe? From nothing, only Allah. He is the only one who can create ex nihilo without using any other thing. Therefore, it is quite strange when, you know, people can create things from the things that have already been created and then begin to worship them. It doesn't make sense to Islam. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, La ilaha illa huwa al-hayy huwa yuhi wa yumit. وَرَبُّكُمْ وَرَبُّ آبَاءُكُمُ الْأَوَّلِينَ. There is no God but He. He it is who gives life and gives death. He is the sustainer and the cherisher to you. and to your earliest ancestors. So now, secondly, then, you know, the divine lordship of Allah, he is the everlasting Rabb. He is the creator of all material and immaterial creatures, unassociated in his sovereignty and creation with any existent being. He is the one. Thirdly, his oneness in his deeds, the highest of which is to give life and cause death. So here it's a La ilaha illa huwa in this ayat, ayat number 8. La ilaha illa huwa, there is no ilah except him. Yuhyi wa yumit, it is he who creates life and death. Rabbukum, he is our, he is your sustainer. Rabbu aba'ikum ul-awwalin, and the sustainers of your ancestors. So, you know, then he is sovereignty and his creation with any existent being. Thirdly, he is his oneness in his deeds, and the highest of which is to give life and cause death. See, that is that he gives life to the dead and thereafter he causes death. Now, with due consideration, you know, to the fact that in these ayat, you know, one is supposed to reason posteriori, you know, to reason out, you know, the unity and, you know, movement of creatures, you know, evidently substantiates proving the necessary being. So this is the wajibul wujud, that Allah is wajibul wujud. So God, the Almighty, you know, the creator of the world, who usually describes himself in this ayat and many other ayat as the creator of the heavens and the earth. So then, you're taking into consideration the admirable system of creation and the marvelous, you know, place of this world, one may to some extent learn the secrets of creation and notice that there is a secret concealed in each and every atom of creatures. I think I will stop here, and I've got another about 4 minutes or so. So, you know, please feel free to ask any questions if you have. If you don't have any questions, then maybe we can continue. Okay, so if no questions, then you know the Mufassirin showing us, you know, so much clarity. Then they said that if you split the heart of each atom, you'll find a sun shining within it. It's so clear, you know. So thus, taking into consideration the admirable system of creation and the marvelous place of this world, one may to some extent learn the secrets of creation and notice that there is a secret concealed in each and every atom of creatures. So you can take the smallest thing, which is atom, and if you even break that, you will see, you know, some, you know, marvelous thing. You will see as if, you know, that the sun, you know, shining within it itself. So, you know, thus, you know, one may attain your total conviction regarding the existence of Allah, the originator of everything, ex nihilo. Ex nihilo simply means, you know, creation of something without anything. That is ex nihilo. Nobody can do it except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the only one who has created all this from absolutely nothing. So it's a wonderful, really, when you think about the origin and the unity of this world, it is just amazing results, you know, that you will arrive at, you know, to know that all creatures function as a links of chain. We are all, you know, as if we are chained, you know, to each other under the command of one all-wise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we acknowledge his unity, that is, there is no other creator except him. La ilaha illa huwa yuhyi wa yumit, rabbukum wa rabbu aba'ukum lawwalin. There is no God but he. It is he who gives life and gives death. He is a sustainer and cherisher to you and to your earliest ancestors. I think I'll stop here because my time is up. And inshallah, then we will continue again from... No, I've still got another 2 or 3 minutes. Okay, so now let's do this. Balhum fi shakki yal'abun. This is ayat number 9. Yet they play about in doubt. So in spite of all this, you know, there are still people who doubt, you know, for taqib yawma ta'ati samaa'u bidukhanin mubin. So this will be then ayat number 10, where, you know, then watch out then for the day that the sky will bring forth a kind of smoke or mist which will be plainly visible. صدق الله العظيم يا الله سبحانه وتعالى قائد ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد